I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. We're bringing together experts, thinkers, and leaders, busting myths, sharing stories, and staying connected when Canadians need it the most. We're having unexpected conversations for unprecedented times. Hi, Ariel. I am so excited to talk to you because I love books and I love to talk about books. And that's what you do for a living. You are a book vlogger. So what does that mean, a book vlogger?
Yes. Well, thank you so much for having me on. I'm super excited to chat. I just feel like we're all very nervous and scared right now, but we're actually making so many wonderful connections, which is beautiful. So I'm glad to be on here to talk about books and to talk about my crazy job. So yeah, like you mentioned, I am a book vlogger or a booktuber, like a YouTuber, but about books. So I started doing this when I was 16 and I just started reviewing books online. I thought, hey, I don't have anyone to talk to about books. I could do this online. So I started uploading these videos where I just would review books or do book hauls. For example, like if I got in a books for my birthday, I'd be like, here are the books I got for my birthday. I'm so excited to read these, et cetera, et cetera. So any book related video that you can imagine, I have probably made or I'm about to make, or like including a bookshelf tour. So like walking people through how I organize my books and et cetera. Yeah.
It's a lot of fun. How do you organize your books?
I organize my books by genre and then by color. So I put together like contemporary books or science fiction books, etc. And then I like to do a little rainbow because I just think it looks so beautiful.
I do mine by color only because the funny thing is about books is I remember what color the book is. Oh, I always remember the color of the book, maybe not the author, maybe not... you know, but I always remember what color a book is. So
yeah, absolutely feel that. Yeah.
So tell me about, how do you like to read books? Because, you know, I have three kids, kids nowadays, they like to, they like to read things on, you know, on their iPad or on their computer or whatever. We always have books in our house. How do you like to read a book, on a tablet or a real book, or does it matter?
Yeah, so I really love a physical book. I am such a fan of a physical book because I don't only think of it as like I'm about to read something. I also think like I am bringing an object into my home. I am like making this a part of my library and my collection. I just think it's such a beautiful thing. I also just, I don't know, I find a lot of satisfaction in the flipping of a page and like getting, like you close the book at the end of the night and you look at it and you can physically see that you're halfway through. Like all of that tactile information just makes me really happy. I have though lately been listening to a lot of audiobooks too. So obviously that's completely digital. I did used to have a couple of audiobooks on CD because we weren't caught up with the times yet. But yeah, now there are so many amazing services, including just like using your local library to get audiobooks. So I have been doing that. But unfortunately, I just have never been able to catch on to the ebook thing. I just don't find them fun.
I agree with you. I like turning a page and the smell of a new book and hearing the spine crack when you open it. And I agree with you. So you have a massive following, and you really do. And you've interviewed some big names. So let's talk about a couple of them. Bill Gates. You interviewed Bill Gates.
Yeah. No, it's
tell
true.
Me about that.
Things have spiraled out of control, Tamara. I don't know what's going on. And for some reason, they think that I am like allowed to do this. And here I am getting to talk to some very cool people. So the Bill Gates situation, every year, the Bill Gates, the Bill and Melinda Foundation, they release an annual letter. And it's kind of a goal setting letter where they talk about the things that they learned in the last year and the things that they're trying to help for the next year, because they're a really big charity organization. And so they were looking for people to collaborate with to talk about these goals and the things that they've learned, etc. And for some reason, I got an email in my inbox. The way that all my lucky, beautiful opportunities happen, the way that I got in touch with you, I just got a beautiful email in my inbox. And it was from the Bill Gates team. And it said he would love to talk to you about anything on this list. And what was really special about that interview was that I had full control about what the idea was, what the questions I asked were. And I ended up having like 20 minutes to record with him, which was so crazy. I was only supposed to have 15 minutes. And yeah. In the end, we just kept talking. And then eventually he left and his like producers were like, he was having so much fun. We didn't want to stop him. And I'm like, that's so cool. So,
and did he talk about books with you?
Yes. So my video idea was to talk to him because he cares a lot about the environment and I care a lot about the environment. So I asked him what his favorite three books that have to do with the environment are. And I got to keep the books afterwards. So that was cool.
Can you tell me what his books were? Do you remember?
Oh, gosh. I actually don't remember because they have very long, complicated
names. I know, right?
They were like mainly like textbooks. One was called The Man Who Fed the World. And it was about a person who was like a farmer and developed this really new and important grain that was able to like produce more quickly and more sustainably. Another one was called Sustainable Energy. And this one was really cool because it was like free, available for free online. And the third one, I think, was called Energy and Civilization. Something like that. And it was like and then of course these have long subtitles, right? But it was by Václav Smil, who is such an interesting writer, but basically write like this is a history of energy. So like, when did we start making energy and how has that looked throughout human history? But Not to plug myself, if you want to hear that conversation, it is such a cool conversation. And it's on my YouTube channel. So anyone
I
can
bet
go
it's
and watch
really
it and,
amazing. I will be watching that. Yeah. Okay, so I want to talk about Michelle Obama because, I mean, I love her. I love her book. You interviewed Michelle Obama. I would kill to interview Michelle Obama.
Yeah. It's funny because, you know, this has happened over the span of say a year, but when you put them like this, just talking to someone, they're like, all right, next up on the docket, Michelle Obama. it's pretty crazy. Yes. So this is part of a show that YouTube Originals was making. So that's the sector of YouTube that makes original programming and kind of higher quality programming. And they started a show called BookTube. And they have like every month, I think they have a new episode that comes out with, you know, a famous author or a person who's published a really big book in the last year. And so I got invited to go on to do this Michelle Obama episode, but I also then got to film some stuff for my own channel. So that was really lucky and cool. But yeah, it was a very...
What was it like?
It was wonderful. It was kind of crazy. The security levels were really intense. So like when we were recording with Michelle Obama, for example, and we're like actually sitting in the room with her, we were locked into the room with her. Like you couldn't go in or out until we were done. And then she was walked away with her security. But earlier in the day, there had been like a bomb sweep and like guard dogs and everything. Mm. Like it was super intense, but very like, very cool. Like you see the bomb squad going around and you're like, imagine her life. Like everywhere she goes has to be swept.
Right.
Super crazy. Right. But then the actual recording with her was wonderful. She is as lovely as you think she is. She is absolutely the kind of person who you can tell is listening to you. Do you know what I mean? Not just like sitting there and like nodding and going like, yes, that's so nice. No, she's like actually listening and cares and very generous with her time. So it was just super fun. And
what's the most memorable thing from talking to her?
Yeah. When we were doing our little one-on-one, I had two little funny moments because before they hit record, they're setting up the cameras and the angles and my glasses always make things difficult for everyone because of the glare. And so I had like an extra minute to sit with Michelle Obama. That's my secret for everyone. Wear glasses when at an important interview. but she First, I think I told her that I liked her nail polish because she was wearing this beautiful blue nail polish. And then she complimented my nail polish. And it was like a very exciting moment for me for some reason. But then we were sitting there and she was like, where are you from? And everyone else was American. And I was like, I'm actually Canadian. I live up in Ottawa because I was doing my master's there at the time. And she was like, oh, gosh, how do Canadians feel about everything that's going on down here in the States? Mm. And I didn't know how to answer such a big question in like 20 seconds. And so all I said was, you know, I think we're really concerned and we wish we could help. And she just took my hand and she was like, I think a lot of people want to help. So it was a really sweet moment. And I will definitely always remember that. She was so nice.
Yeah, no kidding. What an experience. And yeah. And I'm going to assume you also talked about her book.
Yes. So then the entire episode was about her book that had just come out, Becoming, which is her memoir. And it was a really interesting conversation. It was actually very funny because while I did want to read that book eventually, I didn't have it, like I didn't buy it upon release. But I was emailed to see if I wanted to talk to her. And I had about a week between being confirmed and going to meet her. So I have, like, it was a marathon. That me and that book, we really got to know each other. And I was already, like, on a trip to somewhere else. So I was just, like, reading in my hotel room at night. It was hilarious. But yeah, the book obviously is really powerful, really interesting. She's such a great writer and she's had such an interesting life. So it was a great joy to get to talk to her about it.
No kidding. Yeah, her book really struck a chord with a lot of people. So, okay, Margaret Atwood. I know. Okay, Bill Gates, Michelle Obama, Margaret Atwood. This is amazing. Tell me about Margaret.
I would really like to emphasize for the listeners that I feel very pretentious right now and I don't.
No, don't. I think it's, you know what, Ariel? I think this is really inspiring. You love books. You have a passion. You've turned your passion into your career. And this is inspiring for people.
Okay.
You know, it really truly is.
That angle.
Tamara, it's not pretentious at all. No, it's, I am in awe of, the people that you have interviewed and the fact that you have found a way to turn your passion into your career. So good for you. And tell me all about Margaret Atwood now.
Okay. Well, Margaret Atwood is maybe the smartest person I've ever hung out with. She.
What about me?
Except for you, Tamara. close second. Margaret Atwood. So she was very funny and very nice, but also just so intelligent. So like we would ask her a question. It was, again, this was part of that YouTube show, but then I got to do my own thing with her for my own YouTube channel. But during the like long section when we were kind of having a book club about the Testaments, which had just come out, we would ask her a question and she would give these insanely delicately produced answers that just had so much historical context. Mm-hmm. Like clearly she is so well read and well studied that it made me feel like I need to read another 400 books before I can start to like speak at that level. No, but it was a very fascinating conversation. And like I said, whenever we would ask her a question, she would say, well, actually the reason that I did this is because historically this happened in this country and then this happened. And she could name like the dates and names of people I've never heard of. And I had no way of verifying, but like, I was like, she is so, so clever. And obviously as a Canadian, it just was a very lucky thing. I was Canadian like interviewing her because it is an American show. It's YouTube. And so I just felt really lucky that I got to like have a little Canadian representation in there.
Yeah, no kidding. Okay, so let's talk about what's happening now for, you know, with this worldwide pandemic. A lot of us are in isolation. That's what we're supposed to be doing, is staying home. What do books do for us when we're in isolation?
I love that question. I think they can do so much. I think it depends on the kind of book you're reading, I guess, but it can be escapism. It can let you out of that isolation. You know, you can travel anywhere and be somewhere. and not just be there for a little while. I think that's one of the great things about a novel or a book. It takes a while to read it, right? So you get to spend quite a long time somewhere else. Unlike a movie, which is maybe only escapism for 2 hours, with a book, you're going to be trapped there for days or maybe even weeks, right? You're going to be like escaping to this world and thinking about it between while you're reading. But I think it can also really give comfort. If you're rereading an old favorite or a book that you love, which is something that I'm doing right now, like it's such an opportunity to be somewhere that does feel safe, that does feel good and comforting. But it can also be a place of just joy and fun and like silliness. Gosh, I do really love books, so this is becoming a bit of a poem. But I just think that we are so lucky that we do have access to books. And obviously, like, bookshops are closed right now. Mm-hmm. Libraries are closed right now. But we're very lucky that we can borrow ebooks, or most of us have some books lying around our home. Or there are quite a few independent bookshops that are still doing online orders, which is by far the thing I most recommend people do. If you're wanting to get a book, call up your independent bookshop. They are having a really hard time right now. Yeah. And so if you're able to order a book from your local bookshop, that would be a great thing to do at this time.
That's really good advice. And you can also borrow from friends. I've been leaving, I have a lot of books and, you know, one of my friends will call me and say, hey, can I borrow a book? And I pick a book for them and I leave it on my, you know, by my front door outside and they just come by and pick it up. Right.
Oh,
so
it's
a good way
cool.
to share too, right? Because I have lots of books that are in the waiting to read pile or already read pile. And so it's easy to share that. What about journaling? What about writing? What about doing our own thing?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I'm happy to admit I've fallen into the deep cliche of starting a novel during my quarantine. I actually was traveling to London, England. I always have to, for our Canadian friends, I have to like point out not London, Ontario. Nobody else on the planet knows that there's a London, Ontario. I was in London, England a few weeks ago when things like our government hadn't said anything yet and the UK government had absolutely not said anything yet. And so it was a business trip, so I couldn't really cancel it. So I was like, all right. So I went on my trip. But while I was in England, things were starting to close and stuff. And I was like, okay, this is a disaster. Thankfully, I was only there for 4 days, came home and instantly had to enter a quarantine because I live in British Columbia and we had our quarantine measures put in earlier. And so I haven't left the house in like 3 weeks. And I have started writing and I'm so grateful for it. I think that it is so helpful. I mean, I am not a psychologist, so I can't wax poetic too much on it, but there are so many health benefits to journaling. It is often a practice given to people who have gone through trauma, who have gone through a difficult time, people who are processing something that is very hard for them, or which we're all going through right now, which I think is one of the most powerful things about this pandemic, is that it is international, global. We're all going through it. But when you're going through something that you don't understand or can't explain or is making your life more difficult, being able to write that down with the absolute understanding that no one else is going to read it can be so freeing. Whether that is a creative project or just like a nonfiction journal, like here's how I felt today. And I know that I shouldn't be complaining that my birthday party was canceled, but that was sad to me, right? There are certain things that you can say in a journal that maybe you don't feel like you can tweet about or post online because maybe it feels trivial, but it isn't trivial. It's still your life that is being affected. And so being able to actually write that down and communicate it, even if just to yourself, I think is super powerful. Have you been journaling at all?
I always am. And I'm always writing. And, you know, I have dreams of writing a book one day. And you know, it's always the last thing to get to, right, in your busy day-to-day life. But, you know, what you said is really powerful, because there is so much to gain from writing down how you're feeling. It's such an enormous release for a lot of people. And so I agree with everything you said there. And and even for somebody who maybe doesn't journal or doesn't write things down, you know, even if you write down how you're feeling and then just, you know, crumple it up and recycle it or rip it up, it does something to just get it out, you know?
Yes, and it really does.
It really is. So I agree with you on that. And I think it's great that you have decided to start writing a novel, because you never know where things are going to get,
exactly.
Right?
I've decided that this is the great quarantine novel of our times, at least of the Canadian times. This is it, guys. So get ready.
Yeah, there you go. So let's talk about what we're reading. So I have a few books here that I wanted to show you that I'm reading or talk about. And I know you have some too. So
absolutely.
Why don't you go? Are these books that you recommend or books that you're reading right now? Because those are two different things.
Yes. So those are two different things. So these are the books that I recommend people pick up right now. If you Yes.
Before we get to that, you tell me what you're reading right now. I want to know what you are reading.
I am currently reading Weather by Jenny Offal.
I have that book. I haven't read it yet, though.
Okay. It is so good so far. I am absolutely loving it. It is about a librarian who starts working on a podcast. So it's perfect for you, Tamara. So it's about a person who starts working at this podcast kind of as a favor. And the podcast is about kind of the environment and climate change. And so she's reading these letters and submissions from people who are either like vehemently against climate change, denying it, don't think it exists, or people who love it and like love the cause and want to support it, etc. So it's like, I don't know, I haven't finished it yet, so I can't do my final review. But so far, I'm really liking it. And I think it's really beautifully written. And the other thing I'm reading is the biography of Frida by Hayden Herrera. So this is like the main biography that it's kind of the go-to biography on Frida Kahlo. And it's the one that the movie was based on. It is so good so far. I really love Frida Kahlo. I think that she is such a cool human being and that we're all lucky to get to read about her and be inspired by her. And I think especially in this time, I'm really enjoying reading about a brave woman who like went through so much adversity, but still plowed on and made beautiful art. So that's what I'm reading. What are you reading?
Well, some are in my pile. So why don't you go first?
Okay. All right. Well,
some recommendations. Can you hold them up so I can see them too?
Absolutely. Okay. I have them here for you to enjoy. So the first book that I want to recommend everyone is So You've Been Publicly Shamed by John Ronson. So this is nonfiction. It is one of my all-time favorite books. Actually, these are all some of my favorite books just because I want more people to read them. But this is such a fascinating book because it's about public shamings online, and it's about kind of online etiquette, but that makes it sound really boring. It is one of the funniest, most hilarious, uplifting books I've ever read. It is kind of like to sum it up in kind of a little example, you know, we've all heard these stories of someone who like tweets something that they thought was a joke or they thought wasn't that offensive or they didn't mean it in a certain way. And then let's say they go to sleep and they wake up the next day and it has completely blown up. They are being attacked left, right, and center. They're getting like people showing up at their homes and they've been fired, etc. So it is a deep dive exploration into this power that we have with the internet. And what's really fascinating is like it opens up by talking about how public shaming used to be a way that we punished people like in law, like 200 years ago, right? We would like put them in the stocks for people to make fun of in the town square. But we decided to stop using that as a punishment because it was deemed too cruel. And now here we are again doing it online. So it's kind of
I'm writing this down. This is right up my alley.
So You've Been Publicly Shamed by John Ronson. It is hilarious. It's uplifting. It isn't like skewed one way. It isn't saying like we should never do this, because obviously with like things like the Me Too movement, there are great uses of it. So there are ways to do it for good, ways to do it for evil. But I think especially right now, in this time of isolation, when we are all spending so much time online, it's nice to have a bit of a guide, a bit of a lesson in empathy and compassion, being kind to people on the internet. I just absolutely love this book, and I wish more people would do it.
I love it. Okay, I'll give you one of mine. Okay, please. Shut Away. Have you read this book?
I haven't, but it's the perfect title for this time.
This is an amazing book written by a Canadian, Catherine McKercher. She lives in Ontario, former journalist, so shut away. And this is a book about her brother. And her brother was put in an institution just outside of Ottawa when he was 2 years old. He had Down syndrome. This was back in the 60s. And this book is so powerful. I wish everybody would read it because it really, it shows our history of how we have treated people with disabilities worldwide. And it's hard to read at times. It was for me. I have a child with Down syndrome, so it was super, it was powerful for me.
Yeah,
but
I
recommend everybody read Shut Away by Catherine McKercher because you won't be able to put it down and you will learn so much and it will change the way you think about people with disabilities, and it will make you want to make things better. That's
I love that. I think that's really awesome. I think both of our books were both about kind of compassion, you know, being empathetic. I think that's so powerful.
Okay. Next.
All right. Well, my next book is Albatross by Terry Fallis. So this is a Canadian author. Woohoo! I had to bring one in, at least one. So this is a book that just came out last August. I had not heard about it, and I think that that is a crime. It is so good. So I wanted to recommend this one because it is kind of like a wacky adventure. If someone is looking for a bit of escapism right now, this is the book to go to. It is about a teenage boy who is in high school and he gets a new gym teacher. The gym teacher is reading like a scientific journal and there's a study in there from a crazy scientist who thinks that if you measure a body and it has certain proportions, that if you get like you do the maths at the end of it, if you have over 90%, you would be good at a certain sport. And so she decides it would be funny to measure her gym students, and she measures our main character, and he gets like 99% in golf, a sport he doesn't care about, has never played, but he goes and he tries it, and it turns out he's absolutely incredible at golf. And so what happens is this story charts over like 7 years of him becoming a professional golfer. Super famous, like winning every tournament you can imagine. And as a person who, no offense to people who like golf, but as a person who just doesn't really care about golf, I was a little hesitant going into it, but that turned out to be hilarious because the main character also doesn't care about golf. And it's just a story about following your dreams, making sure that you don't fall onto somebody else's path. And even if your path, the thing that you really care about, is a lot harder to attain, going after it anyways. It turned out I couldn't put this book down. It was so much fun.
Good one. Okay. Here's one that I'm reading right now. Untamed by Glennon Doyle.
Love the
cover. Yeah. So you might be able to tell so far, I only usually read nonfiction. And this is Glennon. She lives in Florida. She is married to Abby Wambach, who is a very well-known soccer player. And it's just stories about women, about finding your, you know, your true self and who you are and being untamed.
I love
it. It's a good one. Yeah. Okay. What's your last one?
And if anything, the cover, everyone should go look up the cover. It is so beautiful. Okay. This one was, I decided I should throw in a little science fiction because I know people love science fiction. So this is An Absolutely Remarkable Thing by Hank Green. Oh my God. I love this book so much. The sequel comes out this summer. Hopefully it won't get pushed, but, yeah, it's supposed to come out this summer. So the book is about April. She lives in New York City. She works for a startup company. She's overworked, super exhausted. She's walking home late at night one day and she sees this massive statue and she thinks it's an art installation. And she decides, kind of in her delirium of tiredness and because she realizes she misses art, she decides to make a little YouTube video about it. So she names the statue Carl and she pretends like that it's a robot or whatever. And she posts it online. What she doesn't realize the next morning is that 65 of them have appeared all over the world, and no one has any explanation for them. And what you learn throughout the book is that they're visitors from a different planet. And it really goes, I don't want to spoil it for anyone because it's so much fun, but it goes on such an interesting adventure. It is about, I guess, about like aliens, but mainly it's about our main character, April, who becomes like the fore figure of this whole thing. And because she was the first one to post that video, her video ends up going viral and she ends up becoming like a pundit on the news. People are trying to talk to her, even though she doesn't really know anything about it. She was the first one to know. Right? Right. And it's about like what fame can do to you, how important it is to stick to your values, and I think this is the reason I wanted to recommend it. It's about teamwork and cooperation that these robot things, like, it sounds crazy, but it's so cool. It's about this like collective dream that all humans start to have because of these robots. And we solve something together as humanity. And I feel like that is what we're going through right now, right? Yeah. We have to all work together to self-isolate, to stay at home, physical distance, social distance, whatever term you want. We all have to work together to make sure that we're not spreading this pandemic if we can slow it down. So I think it's such a perfect read for right now.
I love it. And okay, so my last one is called A Bird's Eye View. It's Canadian. Okay, the author lives in British Columbia, and she had breast cancer. She used to work in healthcare in Alberta. And she also has a child with a disability. And these are a series of stories of her experience with healthcare and about bringing empathy, compassion, care, kindness back into healthcare instead of, you know, looking at each person as a person. And also a really good book for this time because we're under so much stress. And, you know, these are, well, as she calls it, stories of a live life in healthcare. And it's really good for now because you can pick it up and just read a chapter quickly and really, you know, gain something from it. So another nonfiction book. You know, before we wrap up, Ariel, and I got to say, I could talk to you forever. what about virtual book clubs? Is that something people can do?
I love this question. Absolutely. I am doing one this weekend with my best friend. We are going to be reading The Hunger Games. We're rereading The Hunger Games because we haven't read it in like a decade. And we thought it would be so fun to do that together. I think that like what I do online very much feels like an online book club, right? I post videos about the books that I'm reading and people reply to me. But there are also like such more specific ways that you can do it with a closer group of friends. So I think that there's kind of two ways that you can do this. The first is to pick a deadline with your friends and then meet and do like a Skype call or a Zoom chat or whatever, FaceTime, whatever video thing you use, and like make sure that you've read it by that date. But the second thing you can do is get like an app like Voxer. I don't know if you've heard of that app. It's orange if anyone's looking for it in the app store, but you can use that to send each other little voicemails. And so you can pre-record, like, I just finished chapter 2, here are my thoughts, and send that right away. So it's a bit more kind of like in the moment as opposed to having to space it out. So yeah, so there are so many great options. I guess I should shout out, on April 16th to the 19th, I am running a readathon online. So I run this readathon every summer. It's called the Reading Rush, and it is so much fun. And it is basically like a giant group book club where we all just hang out and read so much. And I decided to host like a smaller one, but one to like bring us all together, because exactly like the reason that you're asking this question, it is, we're all feeling very isolated right now, but books really can bring us together. So for sure. There are loads of ways.
Well, you know what? The passion and enthusiasm that you have for books I just want to like hang up from you right now and go get my books and just go into a corner and start reading. And really, you're super inspiring, Ariel. And I really, really appreciate it. And for you to take the time to talk to us about books. And don't forget that you can check out Ariel on her YouTube channel. So it's Ariel Bissett, or you can go to her website, which is arielbissett.com. So that's A-R- ArielBissett.com. Ariel, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. I've had a lot of fun. And thank you so much for recommending me some books. There's nothing I love more.
I'm happy about that. Thank you so much. And be sure to join us here on TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart every Tuesday and Thursday. Be well.